Okay, but first of all, thank you also to the organizers for inviting me. What I'll try to do in my brief introductory talks here is to contextualize and examine the drivers, the why behind China's growing strategic priority of the Arctic, and then the Chinese approach or the Chinese tactics to establish a Chinese presence and influence in the Arctic, the how. And then I'll try to have time to open a bit for discussion of the challenges and the implications as they play out in the region and as they play out in US, China and Russia relations. But first, a few words on the developments we see in the Arctic. We heard a bit about this already this morning. The Admiral also touched upon it in his opening remarks. But Arctic politics and security these years are being intertwined with great power politics, with US, China, strategic rivalry more and more. And this became very clear with the US Secretary of State Pompeo's speech in Finland just before the Arctic Council meeting in early May last year. In the speech, he stated that the Arctic has become a region for power and competition. We are entering a new age of strategic engagement in the Arctic. So that's where we have the title of the slide. And the speech was followed by the updated US DOD Arctic strategy in June to last year, with the same overall focus on the Arctic in an area of great power competition and this US-China strategic rivalry. But on the other hand, of course, the Arctic is still a very special region, not least due to the huge distances and the amount of ice that is still, still there that makes all maneuver, civilian and military, very difficult. So the point I want to make with starting here is that as Arctic politics, as Arctic security are increasingly intertwined with great power politics and this US-China strategic rivalry, it becomes even more difficult for China as the only great power without an Arctic territory to ensure its access, to ensure its presence, its influence in the region. And we can discuss later whether it will make the Chinese kind of take a step back. What I sometimes, in some of my publications, has called this strategic retreat from the region. Maybe, of course, with the exception of Russia, maybe also Finland, but at least we're seeing signs of that when we look at Greenland in recent months. But we can get back to that. A few words on the Admiral also mentioned the Chinese in January 2018 came with their first Arctic white paper, where they kind of state what their interests in the region are. And what's very clear in this paper, I took some parts of the paper here. You could say that you can see that they argue for that they're having a legitimate role. Of course, this is all the argumentations that's behind the Chinese near Arctic state concept. And what we see here is new tones. This is a more confident, somewhat more sophisticated and risk-taking approach that they also follow in the Arctic. Previously, they were much more humble, underplaying the Chinese ambitions in the region. So this clearly indicates that they are assigning a growing strategic priority to the Arctic and taking this more confident, somewhat risk-taking approach. And that, of course, is what has caused the strong US counter reactions that we've been seeing, especially the last 6 months. Pompeo stated also in his speech in Finland that there are only Arctic states and non-Arctic states, no third category exists, and claiming otherwise entitled China to exactly nothing. So the US is clearly stating that they see no role for China, they see no, or at least very little role for China in the Arctic. So getting to the why. Why are the Chinese interested? Why is this growing strategic priority of the Arctic? Why is it increasingly important to ensure a Chinese presence and influence in the Arctic? Firstly, China wants to build a solid Arctic, or actually polar, because we see some of the same things in the Antarctic, a strong polar research capacity. It relates to how the melting ice and the climate changes that are happening faster at the poles, well, they are affecting they are affecting also back in China with huge consequences for the Chinese economy as well. But what we are seeing in recent years is, of course, that they are also taking part in what other non-Arctic states are also conducting, what we sometimes call this science diplomacy, that they are using their research activities to legitimize, to strengthen their overall growing presence, and to build relationships in the region with individual Arctic states and stakeholders on multiple levels. So it's on state to state, it's with universities and provinces and regions. Secondly, the second driver is they want to ensure access to energy, raw materials and other resources that the Arctic hold in order to secure and diversify China's supply. But this is also, and I think it's an important point, this is also a question about ensuring China what we call a front-runner position in technology and knowledge. Because to get to the resources in the Arctic, you still need to have the best technology, to have the best knowledge about the region or about the areas you're operating under. So this is part of having the polar regions together with the deep seabed and the outer space as these new strategic frontiers in the Chinese strategic thinking, that these are seen as the areas where the great powers in the coming years will come to compete, and China wants to have a front runner position in these areas. There are simply an expectations that there will be very valuable resources, but also in order to get to the resources, you'll have to have the best knowledge, the best technology. So in that way, it relates to what we heard about yesterday, also the Chinese Made in China or Made in China 2025 plan, and the way that they're in a process of upgrading and restructuring the Chinese economy, wanting to be first in new intervention, innovation and new technologies. Of course, the clear challenge here is that there are a lot of dual-use dimension, and we can return to that. The third driver that we already and the Admiral also touched upon was ensuring access to the Arctic sea routes. For China, it's approximately 30% shorter than through the Strait of Malacca and the Suez Canal, but of course, it's not easy. There's still a lot of ice, but again, it's the long-term perspective, making sure that you have your facilities, your relations built up. And as we already heard about, it's especially the Northern Sea Route that the Chinese are focusing on together with the Russians. The Putin government just before Christmas released a new plan for how the Northern Sea Route should be further prioritized in the Russian planning. So the Chinese, of course, also play a role here. And a lot of it links up to the LNG projects on the Yamal Peninsula. So just to sum up on these drivers, China, of course, has very tangible direct interests in ensuring its access to the Arctic, to the energy resources, the raw materials and the sea routes. But my point also is that the Arctic for the Chinese leadership links up to their focus on ensuring continued economic growth, prosperity, and further plays into this restructuring and upgrading of the Chinese economy and then into their further broader geoeconomic and geostrategic ambitions and plans. Very briefly on the how, the Admiral also touched a bit on that. The how is that Beijing is very keenly aware that China is the only great power that doesn't have Arctic territory and therefore depends on the Arctic state seeing a benefit in having China involved. And therefore it is crucial to establish these Arctic relationships, the knowledge and capabilities on the Arctic, so China has something to offer the Arctic states. So the key focus behind China's enhanced diplomatic and economic activities in the region over the recent years have been to establish these strong and comprehensive relationship with all Arctic states and stakeholders and gradually increase China's presence and influence in Arctic governance institutions. So China seeks to propose a lot of benefits to the Arctic states because if it succeeds in binding China into the region, then on these multiple levels through these win-win agreements on research, resource extraction, infrastructure development, then China is better positioned to manage these unforeseen developments and future attempts to marginalize China in the region. So this is definitely what we've been seeing, this efforts to an expanding range of diplomatic tools to bind China into the region. And this is, of course, what the US is now reacting to and trying to counteract. And that leads me just very briefly to the challenges and implications that I'm sure we'll go to discuss. And the Arctic countries, maybe especially the smaller Arctic countries, are having to deal with in the coming years, because we're already seeing it's increasingly difficult, especially for the smaller Arctic states, to manage in this US-China-Russia strategic rivalry in the region. So how to see how to manage in this, and I can get back to in the Q&A how we see it in Denmark with Greenland, which has been a huge focus and challenge in the recent 6 months. But what we at least try to, or in this recent report that I published, what we try to argue is that there is a need for especially the Nordic Arctic countries to share to a higher extent information, intelligence on some of these things, because there is a lot of common interest in preserving, as the Admiral also mentioned, the Arctic governance institutions, the Arctic cooperation, this exceptional low tension in the region. Of course, the great powers do not have the same concerns. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you.